Hello everyone, welcome back to the lab session. This is the third lab session we are having. In the last session, you had a product dissection experimentation for a printer, and you saw how to do a formal or a systematic way of dissecting a product, identifying the parts, and then looking at the assembly structure, and then preparing a report on the product. So today, we will repeat the same kind of an experiment for a different product. So today we will look at the experimentation of an electric drilling machine, which is a handheld drilling machine. And as you know, a drilling machine has got electrical elements and the mechanical parts. So it's actually a combination of both electrical and electrical electronics and mechanical elements. So we'll try to see how to do the systematic dissection of the product, and then identifying the product structure, as well as look at the parts and its function in the product. So the objectives, as in the previous experiment, here also you will try, you want to understand the function of the product. So what is the overall function of the product, and then what are the parts and sub-assemblies are there in the product. So any product, you will be able to see many parts and some sub-assemblies which actually provide a particular function in the product. So you want to identify all those parts and the sub-assemblies in the product, and then look at how the parts contribute in the overall functioning of the product. So whenever you take out a product from the whenever you take out a part from the product, you need to look at what actually it is doing in the product, what is its function in the product. So you don't need to worry about how do you represent the function at this stage. At least you try to understand what actually it is doing in the product, whether it is providing a power conversion, or it is trying to transmit the power, or it is providing some support. So what actually it is doing in the product need to be identified. And then prepare the parts list, and then prepare an assembly chart. Okay, and the same format what actually we did in the previous class. And look at the opportunities for design improvement. So now after going through this, you look at the product as a designer, and then see what you can do to make it a better product, better product in terms of additional functions or existing functions, or a perceived problem within the product, and how do you actually modify it. That is what actually you need to look. So this will be a general objective in almost all of the experiments, but only thing, the final, the report that you are making may be slightly different in each one of these experiments. That's going to be the difference. So this product is an electric drilling machine, which is a handheld product, handheld machine, and manufactured by the company Bosch. And this is the model GSB400 professional, and the main function is drilling holes into or through material. So it can be either metal, or it can be wood, or any other material can be there, where we can use it for drilling holes. Okay, so just to give you a background, so whenever you try to understand a product, you need to have a bit understanding of the history of the product, how it evolved over a period of time. So just to give you an idea, so electric drill developed from the idea of a hand drill, which originated when there was a need to create a hole or a way through objects, predominantly those made up of stone, metal, or wood. So that was the fundamental requirement. You want to make a hole in a material, that is wood, stone or metal. So that was the requirement. And people used to use stick as a rubbing tool to make holes. So very old time, they used to have sticks, and then it moved to stone, metal, etc. And that was the earliest known use of a hand drill, using the sticks to make holes in a wood is the earliest product. And another similar mention was the bow. Okay, so this kind of a bow, you can actually use it for drilling holes. So you have a tool which is placed on the material on which that hole to be made, and then you have a bow kind of arrangement, and then move the bow to and fro motion, which will be converted to a rotary motion, and then you will be able to make holes. So these things were actually very common in many places, even in India, maybe 30-40 years ago, because most of the carpenters, there were no electricity in the villages, and most of the carpenters were using a kind of mechanism like this to make holes. And later on, after the introduction of electricity only, we started getting, instead of having a reciprocating motion converter, a rotary motion, we started getting electric motors which can actually have direct rotary motion, and then that rotary motion can be connected to the tool, and then we can have drill the holes. So this was basically to reduce the human effort, and it is used lever action to reduce human effort and produce holes deeper than faster. The lever action could be either parallel to the axis or perpendicular to this. So there were different ways of doing it. So when you prepare the report, you can just have a brief history of the drilling machine, and then or the whole procedures followed for making holes, and then how it actually evolved to the current drilling machine. So this is the brief history. Now, what are the steps to be followed for product dissection? So as I mentioned in the previous class also, so remove the screws. So you will see in this case there will be 5 screws that you will be able to see on the product. So remove the screws and give the number, and then put them in a small bowl given to you so that you do not miss it. And then remove the housing, the right housing, and then the inner assembly should be visible. So when you remove the housing, you will be able to see the inner assembly. So remove this mode switch sub assembly, and then that includes the ball washer and a plastic switch. So that is the one sub assembly that you will be able to see. And then the remove the screws which are holding the rest of the assembly. So that you will see, once you remove that, you will be able to see few more screws. So remove those screws, and again write down the procedure which one you are removing first, number them and keep them as separate one. And then the assembly will look like this. And then the chuck assembly can be taken out, and you cannot really further dissect the chuck assembly. So just remove it as a chuck assembly and keep it. There are further parts in it. Of course, you don't need to go into that level of dissection at this stage, because you know what is the purpose of the chuck assembly and how it is working. And then the part X can be removed, which is marked as here. The part X, that is basically the transmission part from where the motor is. The motor, this is the motor which actually provides the torque, and that is transmitted to the tool over here. So you will see an assembly here which actually is the transmission. So you will be able to see the gears and other things, and then you will be able to get all the parts done. So now you have most of the parts taken out. So look at those parts and then try to identify the, of course your TA will help you to identify the main function of these different parts, and the assembly structure also. So after this, you prepare an assembly chart for the product. Okay. So the report format, as in the previous case, we will be doing the same kind of a format in this lab session also. So you will write down the details of the product, as I already mentioned, and then write down the main function of the product, and then write a brief history of the product evolution in terms of the function and the form, and then write down the procedure, what tools you used and how did you did the dissection, and then prepare a list of parts, the parts list which actually contains the part name, material, sketch, manufacturing method and approximate dimensions. So whatever you can identify, or whatever the methods you can identify in the manufacturing. If you don't know, we are not sure, you can discuss with the TA, and then write down the manufacturing methods. And then once you have the parts list, you look at the assembly chart. So the parts, how they, if different parts contribute to a sub-assembly, and how sub-assemblies contribute to the main product can be identified. So all the parts you can assemble them, or you can actually prepare a chart in terms of how the parts are assembled. And that actually leads to a product structure, where you show the assembly, sub-assembly, and the sub-assemblies and the parts. And the last part is basically to observe the product and then give your comments about the product and its functions, and then see what suggestion you can make for improving the product. So this is the way how you will be preparing the report for this product. I hope you have understood this. So now you can actually go to the TA. The TA will show you how to do the product dissection and then how to identify the parts and its function. Okay, so thank you. Go ahead with your experiment.
Hi, I am Siddhan. So I'll today be explaining about the drilling machine. So before you see the drilling machine, I just want to you to guess what are the components that should be inside it. I have some source of power and essentially I'll be converting into some rotational motion, right? So I have some electrical energy, I'm converting into mechanical form of energy. So that's what is called as a machine. And what is a mechanism? So essentially there are two kind of things, right? There is something called mechanism and there is something called machine. So in machine we have one input form of energy and we transform that into some kind of output form of energy. So what is a mechanism? Do you have any idea about it? Just a random guess. So when you hear the word mechanism, what's the first thing that crops up to your mind? Okay, some steps one after another. That is what he's telling, is some links connected to each other. So whenever I move the input link, there will be some form of motion to the output link. So that is what is called as a mechanism. So you provide some input motion and that will be transformed into output motion. And when I use such a mechanism into some kind of a product, so that is called as a machine. Okay, understood? Am I clear? So the thing is, right now I want to you to guess that I'm providing electrical energy and I'm getting some form of rotational energy. So what should be the components that should be present inside a drilling machine? So I'll list it down. What I'll do is I'll list it down, and after we open it, we'll be open this drilling machine, and then we'll be seeing whether the components that you have told matches with it or not, and what are the usefulness of each and every component. Okay. So essentially, what it does is, if I provide you this drilling tool, will you be able to drill something? I provide you this, so will you be able to drill something? You need the drill bit, right? So what it is doing is, essentially a motor is providing that rotational motion. But that rotational motion needs to go into some tool which will provide the cutting action, right? So that is essentially called as a drill bit. So I'll have some sort of a drill bit. Apart from that, I have three components. So let's go sequentially, right? I'll have some sort of a power wire. So the power will go from the power wire. I'll have an on-off switch which will be able to switch it on and off. So do I need to provide some sort of a safety procedure? Suppose there is a child playing around, right? So in case he presses this, I don't want this to move. So I need to provide some child lock button. So this is what is called as a lock button. Okay. So right now I have some sort of a transfer of electrical energy to that of a motor. So I have a motor, then I'll have gears, I have a drill bit. So what's missing? The power is transmitted from the motor. I have the drill bit, but I need something to hold the drill bit. Socket. So essentially this is what is called as a chuck. I'll tell you what this is a chuck, and this is essentially a chuck key. So what it does is, you can see, when I rotate this in one direction, so the diameter of this chuck is increasing. This is essentially a three-finger chuck. So one of the question I want to ask is, why is it a three-finger chuck? Can I make it two? It will slip, right? So essentially what is happening here is, the contact between the drill bit and the chuck is maintained due to the force applied by the chuck, right? So I need to have some sort of a force closure. That is the summation, the algebraic sum of the forces should be zero. So this is what is called as a universal chuck. You can note it down. So all of you can note down the components that you have told me. The first one was motor. The second one is gear. The third one is the drill bit. And the fourth one is the on-off switch. Till now we have guessed these components only, okay? And apart from that, I've told you that there are gears. We'll talk about it separately. What are the gears and what are the different kind of gears and all. And I've told about some sort of a chuck. So chuck is essentially used to hold something of radial symmetry. If I have a square, will I be able to hold it? No, right? So I'll be able to hold cylindrical objects here. In order to hold objects of different dimensions, I'll have different kinds of chucks, okay? So the thing is drilling machine seen now, or was there any previous versions of drilling machine available? So drilling machine is what came 10 to 15 years ago, right? So before that, in villages and all, have you seen any instances of drilling machine or something similar to that? So what he is essentially trying to tell is, we have a sharp pointed object and we have thread around it. Essentially, we'll roll the object and we'll have some sort of a drilling motion. Okay. So the I think the most common example is in villages, everybody used to see, right, how do we make lassi and all. So that is one form of a drilling motion. Essentially, you have some sort of a motion and you are transferring into another sort of motion. What happened after that is, they tried to mechanize it by using V-pelt pulleys. You know about pulleys and all. So I have a pulley here. I have made a V-belt around it and I am transferring power here, which is used to drill the workpiece here. So that is what you see in workshops, huge workshop, they have a universal drilling machine. So that is essentially that. After that, have you heard of the company called Decker, Black Decker? Yeah. So Decker is a company which patented this pistol gun technique. So essentially, I have some sort of a pistol shape, right? I press the trigger, I have some sort of a drilling machine. So that is what they made, a drilling machine into some sort of a portable machine. And what's this company?
Bosch.
And what is Bosch known for? Mechanical tools. So thing is, Bosch came into existence by making automobile parts. Essentially, the first component that they made was not the first component, I guess the most popular component that they made was the fuel injection component. You have seen that in automobile cars and all. So in case you are not able to understand anything, you can ask me. Okay. So, and after that, they made several other components and this is one of the products. So I'll just pass this product, and just by looking at the product, I'll ask you what you can notice about the product and all. You can read about the specs, you can read about the name, and then I'll ask you what the product is all about, and then I'll. So what essentially, when you see this product, the first thing you notice, GSB 400. Okay. So what is 400? So GSB must be some product manufacturing line and all. So in case I have first product line, second product line, so GSB is the code of the product essentially. So but 400 is a number, right? It should mean something. So can you make some guess what 400 should be? Dimension. So in case 400 is a dimension, it will not be 40 centimeter. It will not be 4 meters and it cannot be 4 mm because 4 mm drill bit is very small, right? So it cannot be dimensions. Apart from that, power, or it can be variation of RPM, are you telling? So essentially RPM. So what it can be 400 RPM or it can be 400 watts. So I'll tell you that if you are able to see, when you make a small differential robot, right, and you have two motors, they are essentially 100 RPM motors. So 400 RPM is not a significant amount of number in order to drill materials. Okay. So 400 cannot be the RPM of the motor. So essentially it will be power. So it's a 400 watt. Essentially what it means is, if you use this product for a time period of 1 hour, so 400 watts will be consumed. 1 second, 400 watts will be consumed. Okay. So that is one of the formulas. And why, and how do we get the torque of this? Essentially what I'll do is, I'll find the force, I'll find the radius at which the force is acting, and essentially I'll find the torque of this machine, right? From the torque of the machine, I'll find the power. So power is one of the units that is given. It's given that it is operating at a 220 volts, 220 hertz, so that is, it's operating on AC. And the second thing it's given is the RPM. So the drill bit that is provided with this, you can see here, so it's written 85. When you notice phi on any of the machining component, right, it's essentially the diameter. So essentially 8 mm bit drill bit is provided with this drilling machine. Okay. And apart from that, you can notice that it's 2800 RPM, minute inverse or RPM. So RPM is rotation per minute, right? So rotation is usually a number. So the unit will be 1 by time. So that is frequency, right? So we'll have 2800 RPM. And so on this side, I can see that there is some dimensions that are noted, that is for wood 20 mm, for steel it's 8 mm. So these are essentially the dimension of the drill bit that are provided. So in order to drill steel, you will essentially need that. This is the general dimension that they are noting. So you need to use a drill bit of 8 mm or 20 mm. And what's the speed of this? So you can see that on no load condition, it's 2800. That was noted on this And on loaded condition, the impact rate, it's 44,800. So what is this impact rate? When I'm drilling something, do I have some sort of impact? I have some sort of impact. And essentially, does it come on every, if I'm drilling this wood, will I have some impact? So the common example that you have seen that when I use a drilling machine on a road, so they will have huge impacts, right? But when I drill something like a wood or steel, it will be more smooth. So that is essentially when I drill something which is brittle and more concrete, I'll have some sort of impact force. And this is the essentially the RPM that is provided at this impact load. Okay. So right now we'll try to open this and we'll see all of the components. So what I want you to do is,
this is also a flat and this is a cutting tool. And we have this sort of two screwdrivers.
So it will have some sort of thread. It will have some sort of thread. So essentially, the entire screw will have two diameters. One is the diameter of the screw, and one is the diameter of the inside component, right? So it will define the overall, that is the nominal diameter, a sub function of the maximum as well as the minimum diameter. And the second thing that you can notice is the pitch. So when we'll remove other screws, you'll notice that some pitch, the pitch of this screw is different from the pitch of other screws, and I'll tell you why it is. So first thing is, it is a cross-threaded screw. It has a pointed head, and the pitch is not, pitch is essentially a little bit less, right? So you need to rotate it more in order to go to a certain depth. Okay. So the second component is remove the plastic casing. You can write it and paste. Okay, removing the screws, right? The second step was removing the plastic casing. So initially we noted down few components. The one is motor, we can find it here. Okay. The second one is gears. Also, where are the gears? Okay, so these are the gears. Okay, we have found some sort of a gear. And the third is a drill bit. So drill bit is some accessory that will be provided and all. On-off switch, we have an on-off switch, but what are the components that we are not able to guess? We noted that there are some vents on the product, okay? So in case, in order to dissipate heat from this product, we need to have some sort of exhaust fan, right? So somebody was telling about this. Essentially, you are telling about that. So this is the cooling fan that we have, okay? The first note, in case you want to notice it, you can see that the maximum number of vents is provided here because the fan is provided here. So this is the cooling fan. You can write it on a separate side, that the components that we were not able to guess. And the second thing is, what's this small component? Adapter, not essentially adapter. Battery, no, because we are providing it with some sort of power, right? Adapter, so essentially adapter will convert, it will be a step down or a step up, right? But this is not some sort of adapter. So essentially I'm doing some sort of conversion here. So I'm providing an AC, and there must be some sort of a component, that is the electrical component, that will be providing the initial torque and all. So essentially, when you see that in automobile engines, when you kick start a bike, right, there is something called as a spark plug. Yeah. So spark plug is used to initiate the piston action. Just a spark which will ignite the fire and keep the cycle going. In case of electrical components, the same function is provided by a capacitor. Okay. So you will have some sort of a, so you have, motor is essentially the interaction between two magnetic fields, right? So you'll have some sort of a back EMF in a motor. In order to kick start that motion, the rotary motion, you'll have some sort of a capacitor which will keep it charged at the end. So providing I have some sort of a power, so what essentially this will do, it will have a jerky motion, right? But I don't want to provide that jerky motion. So when I switch it off, it will have some sort of a charge stored over here. So when I start it, it will avoid that jerky motion of the drill machine.
And the second thing which we are able to note is, see, drill machine can be made with the help of a motor, right? But when you hold it, it's kind of a bit heavy. So why do we need to make it heavy? Is it a necessary characteristic, or we can make it light? So the thing is, more heavy the thing is, the more inertia it will have. And more inertia it will have, the more force you need to apply in order to move it, right? So when you need to drill something, you need to make sure that the drill that you are making is stable, right? It's perfectly aligned with the workpiece. So for that, in order to happen, you need to make it heavy. Okay. So the second thing is, we'll remove the power casing. We'll remove these two, these three screws. You can note the third step. Remove the power assembly. This small screws. I have provided an AC. So I have two wires. These two are the power cord that are going to the machine. So I have a capacitor here which will charge and discharge, and it will just avoid it from having the jerky motion. So in case it will have some back EMF, it will be able to counter that. So what's back EMF and how is the interaction happening inside a motor? I'll explain you when we'll open the entire motor. Okay. So the third component is, we'll remove this. We have removed this. So here you can see that I've removed the power cord. And I can also remove the capacitor. So this is a capacitor. Okay. So a capacitor will have some units in farads. So it will have some units in farad, and it will be able to store some charge. So it's essentially 15 microfarads. You can see it here. Okay. So I'll ask you, have you seen a capacitor anywhere other than this? Have you heard electricians in your house telling that we need to change the capacitor or something? Fans, right? So in that case also, I need to have some sort of a rotational motion, right? And capacitor, essentially what it does is, it will store the charge and it will make the motion smooth. In case you switch on the fan, you'll provide some amount of voltage to it, right? Essentially some, suppose I'll provide 20 volts, 30 volts, 40 volts, in this case 220 volts. So in case of 220 volts, it will fast rotating, it will have a jerky motion. So capacitor, it will do, it will first charge it up, and during this charge period, it will provide some amount of energy to it, so that this motion is not at all jerky. Okay. So now what I will do is, I will remove the chuck assembly from the drilling machine. So this is essentially called the chuck assembly, right? Because it is used to hold the chuck. So I will remove these two screws. The pitch, right? So you can see that here the pitch is not that uniform, but in this case it's a machine screw. Okay, so machine screw is something that you make in a lathe machine. Have you seen the lathe machine? So essentially there are, for in order to make these grooves, right, essentially this is a cylindrical rod and I make grooves on this, helical screw grooves on this. So, and in this case I have to maintain a certain amount of pitch. So in order to hold metallic components, I'll use something called as a machine screw. In this case, the pitch will be much lesser, so that it is able to hold the components more tightly. And the second thing that you can notice is, it has a pointed head, and this has, this is not a pointed head. Okay. So now I can see that this is a, I can remove this, but it is attached to this. Okay. So I need to remove this too. And what is this? When we remove this, we'll notice what components are coming out of it, and then I'll explain you what it is. Okay, try removing this too. And this is also cross-headed, and it's not a machine screw. Okay, okay. So right now what I'll do is, you can notice that this component takes power from the power switch, and it is connected to the motor via these two things, right, these two wires. So I'll remove these two wires. Okay. And somebody try lifting this up. So when you pulled it, something came out of it. I just want three people take this, three people take this, and tell me what it is. Is it a magnet? In case it's a magnet, it will stick to the iron piece, right? Okay, so to give the power to this motor. So to give the power to this motor, I can use a wire. I can use any sort of component other than graphite, right? But why graphite? First thing, it's a conductor. Graphite is a conductor. The second thing is, it has the least amount of friction, because of the carbon atoms between it, it is able to slide
and it has the least amount of friction, right? So that is the reason we use it. Not the least, but it has some amount of friction. So the second thing what you want, you can notice here is, so these are spring loaded. Yeah, to hold it. And the other thing that you can notice is, due to successive rotation, it is, there is wear and tear in this carbon brush. Okay, so now I can remove this entire casing, right? Let me see if I am able to remove it. Yeah, so I am able to remove the entire casing. Okay, so the first I'll remove this, the entire chuck assembly. The first thing that you can notice is this is some sort of a gear, and I told that gear was used for transforming motion. Okay, so what kind of gear is this? Helical bevel gear. Okay, so I'll tell you the different types of gear. The most common form of gear that you'll see anywhere is spur gears. Okay, so what you know what a spur gear is, right? Essentially, I'll have a circle, I'll have some sort of a teeth. Okay, and this is helical gear. So in case of a helical gear, the teeth will be in case of a spiral manner. So what's the main advantage of a helical gear? So I'll have some sort of spiral here. I'll have the corresponding sort of a spiral on the other teeth. Okay. So in case of a spur gear, you see that I have this teeth, I have the other teeth. I need to have a point contact between these two teeth. When this contact is lost, I need to rely on the other teeth for transforming the motion. Okay. But in case of a helical gear, I'll have some sort of helix here, I'll have the corresponding helical here. So I'll have entirely a line contact. Okay. So essentially the difference between these two are, in order to transmit more amount of force, I need to have a larger contact area for this. Okay. So in mechanisms, maybe you have read higher pair and lower pair, or you'll be reading about it. So higher pair is essentially where you will have a line contact, line or a plane contact. And lower pair is where I'll have a point contact. So what are the different kinds of gears? One is spur gear, one is helical gear, and he told some sort of a bevel gear. So what is a bevel gear?
90 degree
rotation. So can you tell me one example where I can use bevel gear? Swing machine. Okay. Apart from that, so the swing machine is kind of a, the first thing when you think of bevel gears, that should not be the first example that strikes your mind, right? The first should be, I guess, any example that you will tell. Swing machine is obviously one of the applications of bevel gear. But have you seen a car? Car. So in car, I have some sort of an engine, right? I have some sort of an engine. So the power will be transmitted along the axis of the engine. But you need to transmit the power to the wheels, right? So the wheels are essentially 90 degrees. So you need some sort of a bevel gear in order to transmit those forces. So the entire assembly in car, what it is done is, it's kind of a differential. So I can rotate it with different RPMs also. When you're making a turn, essentially you are having a lower RPM in the inward wheel, right? And having a greater RPM at the outward wheel. So you'll have some sort of a differential there. So the essentially the most intuitive form of a bevel gear is, I can have 90 degree, I can have 45 degree as well. Okay. I can have 60 degree as well. So this is called as a bevel gear. Apart from that, I can have worm gear also. I can have rack and pinion also. So worm and rack and pinion both are similar kind of gear transmission systems, where essentially I'll have some sort of a rotary motion and I want to transmit it into linear motion. So essentially when you'll be going to central workshop and seeing the lathe machines and all, you'll see that we will be essentially rotating one of the work pieces and there will be translation motion along the way. Understood what I'm saying? Essentially what it will be is, there will be one sort of a circle which will have some teeth, and there will be one sort of a plane which will have some teeth. So when I'll move this, the entire table will move forward or backward, right? Okay, so this is the entire mechanism of rack and pinion or worm. Worm is essentially I'll have some sort of a motion along the vertical axis. Okay. Yeah, so essentially you'll rotate this one and I'll have some sort of a vertical motion. Okay. So apart from that, I have something called as a planetary gear as well. Okay. So one of you mentioned that one of the possible things that we can do is, we can increase or decrease the RPM of the machine. Okay. So in order to increase or decrease RPM of the machine, what do we use in case of bikes? What do we use? bikes. So in case you are not so familiar with the automobiles, all of you can ride bikes, right? Or cycles in case. So in case we need to change the speed of a cycle, we press a clutch and we change the gear. That is the same in case of bikes, right? In case of cycles, we have different gears, size ratio of the gears, right? So we change the RPM of the entire bicycle with it. In case of a drilling machine, the same can happen. But in case of a bike, I have a clutch set which will attach to different size of gears. But in case of a drilling machine, the size is very compact. You cannot have a clutch set for this drilling machine. So I have some sort of a planetary gear system. So this is essentially, I'll have three gears, and this gear head will have different sort of sizes. So if I need to rotate this one, I'll have some sort of a transfer between this and this. If I need to rotate this one, I'll have some sort of transfer between this and this. Okay. So it's used in a drilling machine. It's also used in some kind of automobiles also. So you can just surf through the internet about the planetary gear. You'll note down the different kind of gears. So what are the different kind of gears that I told you about? I'll hide this. Spur gear, helical gear, bevel gear, rack and pinion, worm gear, and planetary gear. Okay. So this is essentially a, this is not a spur, right? So spur will have the teeth horizontal. So in case it's helical, it will have some sort of a curve. Okay. So and why it is used? If you are able to transmit large amount of forces, we need something to have permanent contact, right? So line contact is better than a point contact. That's intuitive, right? So we'll have some sort of a helical gear between these two components. Okay. So this is the chuck assembly that I have removed, and we can notice here that this is the component which is supporting the motor or transforming the rotatory motion from the motor to the chuck assembly, right? And in order to, so this is similar to something called something in the rim of your bicycles. So when you rotate a cycle, you have some sort of a rotatory component, and you have to hold it with some sort of a support, right? So what is the support that we use in cycles? Essentially, in cycles, we'll have some sort of a outer casing where the entire wheel will go. But in case this wheel is subjected to some kind of a, this wheel comes in front of a hump and all, so we'll have some sort of a forces acting in this direction, right? So I need to transmit rotary motion, and I also need to withstand those forces that which are coming with the wheel. So in case of a bicycle, you'll have some sort of a ball bearing. Have you noticed when they repair cycles, they'll come up with small balls, right? There are 16, 32 and all. So in this case, can you see some of these? Essentially, if I rotate this, I'm able to rotate, right? A bearing. This is what we called as a bearing, right? It's able to transmit motion. It's essentially aluminium or mild steel. I guess it will be mild steel. You can use a spring, right? You can just mount a spring here, and in case it's subjected to this force, the spring will compress and then make it restore its original shape. Okay. So in our case, radial bearing can be some sort of a ball bearing. It can be some sort of a roller bearing as well. And essentially, roller bearing is better than the ball bearing because it will have line contact, more area of contact. So more force that it is able to sustain, or less pressure. Okay. And apart from this, when you, in case you have the opportunity to visit any of the machine shops, right, who are repairing the vehicles and all, you'll see that when they remove the wheel of a car, right, they'll have some sort of a taper roller bearing. So this is what I call as a taper roller bearing. You have seen it, right? So these are the taper rollers. So what is the advantage of this in compared to this? Nothing complicated, just a simple concept. So suppose I have a taper roller bearing, what is the direction of force that I'll transmit it to? This, right? So I can resolve it into two directions, right? That is what I need. I need to support some sort of axial force. I need to support some sort of a radial force as well. So this is called as a taper roller bearings. And the thing is this
the entire set of bearings that they have in automobile or machining industry nowadays? No, there are many different sort of bearings, but these are the things that you need to understand a drill machine. Okay, so I have removed this. This is the chuck assembly. This is the component that is enclosing the motor as well as the chuck assembly. Now what I'll do is I'll remove the cooling fan. So what's this? Armature coil, right? So forget about armature coil. The thing is, on seeing this, what can you see? And they have some sort of a separation between them. Okay. So I'm making some sort of, using a copper coil, what can I have? I can have some sort of electric field, I can have some sort of a magnetic field, and there are separation between them. So I need to have magnetic field or electric field of separate polarity. Okay, that's what is happening. So I have some sort of a step 9 is remove the armature field from the motor. Okay, so how does a motor work? Electromagnetic field. Okay, I'll have some sort of an interaction between electromagnetic field. And how is the electromagnetic field generated? So the thing is, I have some sort of a force acting on a current carrying coil, right? So if I have a magnetic field north and south, okay, I can have the magnetic field like this also, north and south. And if I have a velocity in this direction, that is a charge moving in this direction, what will be the direction of the force? So this is the direction of magnetic field, this is the direction of the current, and V cross B will be the force acting on a current carrying coil. So essentially, if this is the magnetic field and this is the current carrying coil, if I place it in this direction, there is a force which is acting on it on the downward direction. But I need to produce some sort of a rotary motion. In order to have some sort of a rotary motion, I need to have some sort of torque or couple, that is forces in the opposite direction. So how can I have it? I can have it in this direction. So I have a current in this direction which is coming back in this direction. So I have a positive polarity here, negative polarity here. So you told me that this is V, this is B. So this is V cross B. V is the charge flowing through the V. So Q is the amount of charge. Okay. So if I guess 2 coulombs of, if I need to increase the amount of force, I'll just increase the amount of charge that it is carrying. So essentially, think of it as an electron that is passing through a coil of wire. Okay. So if 2 electrons are passing, greater the amount of force. So V is the direction. Essentially, I can write it as a Q V dot B sin theta. So just remind me about sin theta in case I forget. Okay. So essentially, I'll have V is in this direction, B is in this direction, V cross B will be in the downward direction. I'll have a force in this direction, I'll have a force in this direction. Okay. So essentially, my field will rotate in this direction. So after having something like this, now it is in this direction. So V is in this, B is in this, V cross B is in this direction, and the opposite is in this direction. So is there any couple acting on the conductor now? No, right? So essentially, at this point of time, I'll have no couple acting on the conductor. Okay. So the entire rotary motion will be dependent on inertia. So it's moving in this direction, and it will keep moving in that direction. And the thing is, suppose till 90 degree, it's moving completely fine. After 90 degree, it will depend on inertia. And the thing is, right now, I have the coil twisted. Okay. So I have this kind of motion, but the current direction is this in this direction, and it's this in this direction. The current direction is reversed, right? So you can see that the couple is also reversed. Initially, it was in this direction, so it was in this way, it was rotating like this. Right now, it's in this direction, so there is a couple in this direction. So I cannot have a continuous rotary motion. It will have some sort of a reciprocatory motion. Am I clear, or should I make it understand again? Clear, right? I have two coils, V is moving in this direction, there is a torque, it's going like this. At this point of time,
forces in this direction, forces in this direction, there is no torque. It's completely dependent on inertia. The moment it is turning like this, it is having torque in the opposite direction. So I want to avoid that problem. How do I avoid it? DC, I'm using DC current, right? We can use brushes, but the thing is, brushes is used to transmit just the current. Yeah, that's the essential reason. So what I want to do is, when I'm in theta, that's perfectly fine. But when I'm moving in the opposite direction, I need to change the polarity. So right now, what I'll do is, I'll make it exactly like this. So I need to have something in order to change the polarity of this current carrying coil when it is moving in theta greater than 90 degree. So I'll have some sort of coils like this. These are the spring loaded slip rings. This is essentially what is called as, do you know the name? Commutator. Okay. So this is essentially called as a commutator. So when I'm in 90 degree, it's essentially like this. And I am greater than 90 degree, it has rotated. Okay. So the polarity is also rotated. Okay. So the thing is, now I told you, so I also need to have some connections here in order to make it north and south. Okay. So the entire current that is passing from this positive and negative polarity is making this a magnet, a current carrying coil, and also this as an electromagnet. And depending upon, so I have this circuit, and if both of these circuits are connected in parallel, I'll have some sort of a shunt DC motor. Shunt DC motor in the case that the connection of what is this field magnet, right? And the connection of armature magnet are both connected in parallel. Okay. And in case they are connected in series, it will be series DC motor. And the thing is, so right now I have, so you can see that essentially if I take a quarter of this coil, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So there will be 16 such armature coils passing around it. So essentially, how can you visualize it? It is one north, one south, one north, one south, one north, one south, essentially a current carrying conductor. So every time there is motion among this, there is a couple generated in every coil. And in case one of the coil is dependent on inertia, the other coils are driving it to move forward. Okay. So I have one sort of a current carrying conductor going through here. So suppose my current carrying conductor is now in this manner. So the slip rings are no more in contact with the commutator. So there is no current supplied to this, and there is no couple acting on this. So the entire coil is dependent on inertia in order to move. But I want to avoid it. One thing what I can do is I can make the inertia of the coil more. That is, make this more heavy. But is this the only solution? No, right? I can have multiple armature fields. So I have one current carrying conductor like this. I'll have second perpendicular to it. So I can have a second current carrying conductor perpendicular to it. So in this armature field, how many poles are there? 16. And how do we count the number of poles? Just take the quarter, count the number of poles, multiplied by 4. Okay. So what, just in a nutshell, any one of you can tell me, what did I tell about motor? The thing is, what is the current, what's the force applied on a current carrying coil when it is in a magnetic field? Torque is not applied, it will be on Lorentz force, right? Some sort of Lorentz force is applied. Okay, so Lorentz force, when opposite Lorentz forces act on each other, there will be a couple on it. And how do I maintain continuous motion? By changing the polarity. And for changing the polarity, I need to have some sort of a conductor. So I use graphite because it has less friction because of the interstitial carbon atoms, and I reverse the polarity. The thing is, how do I avoid the problem of inertia? By having secondary coils or multiple coils. Okay. Secondary coils. The thing is, there is nothing sort of a secondary coil. There are multiple armature fields. Okay. Rather than having a single current carrying coil, I have multiple. Okay. So the thing is, I told you that I am providing DC here, right? But what's the power that we are providing it?
AC.
AC. So how is it operating now? So that's the main thing that you have to find out. Okay. So this motor is something called as a universal DC motor. I'll just give you a hint about it. I just want you to find it. It's just I guess 2 to 5 minutes read on the internet. That's it. So there are DC motors which run in DC polarity. There are AC motors which run in AC polarity. So what's the difference between AC and DC? First of all,
AC is reverse polarity.
So you can see that can be there is a change in phase between the current. Okay. So you can see that in DC I can have 2 wires, but in AC I'll have 3 wires, R, Y, B. Red, yellow, blue, or red, yellow, brown, something of that sort. So there are some motors for DC, there are some motors for AC, and there are some motors which are called as universal motors, which work for DC as well as for AC. Okay. So the thing is, if I have some sort of an AC and I want to convert to some sort of a DC motor, how do I do it? I can have some sort of a rectifier motion, right? So for a rectifier, I need a capacitor, and a capacitor is well present here. Okay. So I just want you to study how AC is converted to DC or how DC is converted to AC and how does a universal motor work. Okay. So that will be the last part of your report. You have to write it. Okay. Okay. So these are all the separate parts. So what I want you to do is you'll follow the reverse manner in order to do it. So I just want you to tell what are the steps that we followed in order to disassemble the entire thing. The first step was remove the plastic screws, right? So here we have all the screws that are present. So in screws we saw that there are two kind of screws, cross-headed and flat-headed, and for them we had two type of screwdrivers as well. Okay. And this was the first step. The second step was to remove the plastic casing. So there are two parts of the plastic casing, we removed them. The third step was remove the power cord. We removed the power cord and we saw that there was a capacitor. So a capacitor can have essentially two functions. It can be used for the working of a universal motor as well, and the second thing, for it can store some sort of energy to prevent the jerky motion or to avoid back EMF. Okay. So we saw that. Okay, so what does back EMF mean? The thing is, I'm moving. So essentially told that this is a current carrying coil, right? So this current carrying coil will also have a magnetic field attached to that. Okay, and when you find the magnetic field of this, both of them will have some sort of a opposite magnetic field. Okay, so they are opposing each other and you are trying to make the motion. So that is what is back EMF. In order to make the motion, you need to oppose that EMF, that is electromotive force. So because of that EMF also some amount of potential is present, right? So the thing is, third is remove the power cord. We removed the power cord, we saw some sort of a capacitor. The fourth is remove the capacitor. Fifth is remove the chuck assembly. So the chuck assembly is used to hold something of radial symmetry. This is a three-fingered chuck assembly, and three-fingered is used to have force closure. The summation of all the forces should be zero. We thought that it was a plastic casing, but on removing that, we saw that there are two carbon brushes attached to it by means of spring, and these were spring-loaded slip rings, which are in connection to the commutator. So this is the commutator. This is the armature coil, and this is the field magnet. So due to the magnetic field interaction between the field magnet and the armature coil, it leads to rotation of a motor. And this is what kind of motor? This is universal motor. Okay, and it's up to you to find out how does this work. I have given you a hint. Okay, essentially a rectifier circuit will be used. Okay, so this is, when I close this, so this is essentially a mode switch. There is a hammer here. There is some sort of a drilling motion here. So in case of a hammering action, so when does a hammering motion come into play? This will have some role to play. I'll tell you about this. And the other thing that I missed is this one. So what essentially is this? This is just in order to transmit the power. Okay, so these are roller bearing here. So I'll have some sort of a motion here which will be transmitted to the other thing. What's this? Have you seen this kind of a structure anywhere? You have seen this in engines, right? So the thing is, I want to dissipate heat, right? I need to have some sort of a surface area, which is, so these are essentially called as fins. And where can you see this? The corners of the engine will not be smooth, right? You'll have some sort of a corrugated surface. So more the surface area, more is the amount of heat dissipated in it. And the other thing is,
When you saw that the motor was fixed here, I was trying to move this. I was trying to move this, but I was not able to move it. So there must be some sort of an interlocking structure, right? That was preventing me to move. Have you noticed it? When I removed the outer bracing, I was trying to move, but it is not moving. So this is the interlocking motion. So try to rotate it in this direction. Try to rotate it in clockwise direction. No, hold this. You'll not be able to move, right? The thing is, if this joint is tight enough, right now what's happening is I'm not able to hold it. If this joint is tight enough, so it will have rotation in one direction is possible, but rotation in the other direction is not possible. Okay? In this direction it's possible, in this direction it's not possible. So this is the interlocking mechanism. See, this interlocks with this. There are teeth here. In this direction it can rotate, in this direction it will sit. Okay? So can this gear be used for inversing the RPM? I have clockwise RPM. I want to rotate it anti-clockwise. Can this be used? No, right? Because of this interlocking mechanism. And where can I use the application of rotating the RPM? So I have clockwise motion now. I want to have anti-clockwise motion. In case I have some sort of a mechanism, some sort of a gear motion. Okay, in order to reverse the RPM. Where can I find the application of reversing the RPM of the motor? In removing screws. Suppose you want to tighten the screw, you need clockwise motion. In remove a screw, you need the opposite RPM, right? So one of the modification of this will be reverse the RPM so that we can tighten as well as remove the screws. Okay, so what I want you to do is one by one you try to move in the opposite manner. So remove the entire field magnet, you will try to put it in and we'll try to assemble the overall part, right? I'll just try to help you out in case you are not able to do it. Okay, chalo. The first three things, when I press it, it will have some sort of a spring motion, right? And in this case, there is a ball bearing here. Somebody has removed it. There is a ball bearing here. In this case, there is a ball bearing. So if in case I'm moving it in this manner, the entire force will be acting on this point. Okay, and if I have a Hammini action, this will be able to sustain the axial forces. Okay, and in case I'm drilling steel or any other structure where I need the drill bit to be entirely rigid, I don't need it to move. So I'll have a ball bearing in this direction so that it will not allow any motion, but I need to support the rotatory motion, right? So ball bearing will essentially slide in this place. This is the ball bearing, this is the entire drill bit. So I'll rotate this, the ball bearing will roll, but it will not allow any motion in the axial direction. Is this clear? So this is essentially a mode switch, and I told you that mode switch was essentially used for drilling motion. In the case of drilling motion, which will come into play, the spring or the ball bearing? I'm asking you. Suppose I have this, what will come? The ball bearing or the spring? Ball bearing, right? I don't want the drill bit to move, so I'll have the ball bearing. In case there is a hammering action, then the spring will come. Am I clear? Okay, so do the test. Yeah, sure, you can take photos. This is just a component used. You can term it as a connecting component or a transmitting component. There is no such sort of a name for this. Okay, the other thing is, I told that how do we manufacture them, right? So once you assemble them, we'll note all the components and we'll talk about how do we manufacture them. Okay. You can note this as a transmitting component or a transmission component. Okay. So what's the 10th step? Remove the entire field magnet. So we'll try to put the field magnet in. From which direction is the field magnet going in? Okay, so this direction. You can put it separately and then hold it. So right now step 10 is done. Right now step 10 is done. So what's the 9th step? Fan. Don't push it. Yeah, it's fine. So the step 9 is done. What's the 8th step? 8 is also done. What's the 7th step? Remove bearing from chuck assembly. So you can put the bearing in. This is the locking component. What you can do is, first assemble it here and then you can directly put it there. It should be in the opposite direction, right? Yeah. Okay. And both of these gears should mesh with each other. It's meshing with each other. Perfect. Okay. So now step 7 is done. So the next group can come. Okay, now it's resting. I'll just check if it is fixed properly. Yeah, now it's not moving. Now this is also not moving. Okay, so the step removing plastic casing. Yeah, so before removing the plastic casing, what do you need to do? Slip rings, yeah, you need to hold the slip rings and also make sure that the wires are connected, okay, because after inserting it you will not be able to put the wires. So we remove two our wires. We'll put those two wires in. Where did we remove it from? Yeah,
actually this should come
opposite
this field magnet.
Yeah, it's okay. No, it will not go in that manner. No, there is just a slot here. Slot on the top. Just be careful with it. Yeah. Okay. So the thing is, I just want you to ask a question. After assembling it, how many of you think this will work? Will this work? After assembling this, will it work? Yes, no. How many are in favor of yes? Where is the other man? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Where is the other man? He has gone to water dispenser. You need some water? Need a pen? What do you need? So the thing is, after connecting this, how many of you think that this will work? People in favor of yes. Raise your hands. Only 3, 4 at least. Little optimism. So the thing is, there are 4 coils, right? But there are only 2 wires. So I need to have coils from 2 coils from here going in the same direction. Okay. You can see that there are these slots are here as well as here. Okay. So I need to have 2 of these coils going here as well. So that has been purposely done in case somebody tries to press this. So there is one here and one in the other direction, right? So if I have 4 of these wires and I connect them, this will work. Okay. So which step were we in? Removing the plastic housing. Yeah. Try to put the wires. Okay. And we'll slip ring has not been put. We'll put the capacitor as well in case you are fixing this.
you try putting the
but
no, so it will go like this. So what do you need to do is, suppose I put this, I need to have the slip rings also in place, right? So you need to press the slip rings, push it. So this is the hardest step, let us see.
Make sure the wires are not in the way. Or if you are facing any trouble, remove the wire. Okay, so what you need to do is, you cannot do it like this way. So you essentially push it, push both of them, then put it in place. Try to push it and then put it. The wear and tear component, put it in the other side. Yeah, done. So are the screws in place?
Yeah.
It's in place, right? Okay. Hold that. Yeah.
Yeah, now there are three of them. So no, you
will be down.
Okay.
This one was not here first.
Okay.
Downside.
Okay. So we'll have one here. One here. Okay. Screws are here. Try putting it here. One of the wires. Black. Yeah. Yeah, the black one.
It will be white, black, white, black. I guess the opposite side. Wait. We need to remove this. Oops. I'm sorry. Yeah. So now you can put it, right? Now there is, I guess, one left. Two from this.
But it's easy to put these two here.
On the front, right? Yeah, you're telling me. Okay. Yeah. You can put it here. It's in place? Yeah. Okay. Chalo. Put this. Yeah. Put this here and put this here. Now this should work, right? I have four wires connecting the four wires. Okay. So till which step are we in? Remove power cord, remove the capacitor, it's done. They remove the plastic case, remove faucet. So the thing is, what do we need to do now? We need to, yeah, capacitor we have not added. We'll add it. We need to pull that out. We need to pull that out. We need to pull it out. Just provide some space. It's just like it's needed. Okay, we have put the capacitor in place. Now we'll try to seal the, what's this?
Chuck assembly.
Chuck assembly. Okay. Press the flathead one. Okay. Yeah, this is used to tighten and that's fine. So two of them there.
Use a cross-threaded screw, yeah. Okay, this is done. Yeah, we'll connect the power assembly. Okay, so I'll just check everything is tight or not.
This is not very tight.
Yeah, when I put the casing,
it will be tight.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. So how many screws do we need to put?
Six.
We have six, but I guess there are many screws, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, so make sure the screws are symmetric, right? If you are putting in one direction, put in the other direction as well. Because some of the screws are missing, right? So front two, back two are most important. Okay, the thing is, one of the groups, what they did was, they did not put the ball bearing. So we lost the ball bearing. So what do you think that after assembling all of this, what should be the final step?
Check
if all the components are there or not. I guess the most intuitive step would be just shake the component, right? In case there is something missing or some screws are light, there will be some sort of vibration. Yeah. So there will be, in case the ball bearing is inside and it's not fixed properly, it will make the shaking. So in case I get a chance, I'll just show you this is working or not. Most probably this will not be working, because the thing is, the field magnet and the armature coil, both of them will have the same polarity, then only they will rotate, right? So the thing is, each of the groups will disassemble the last batch, they had many number of people. So they have replaced all the field magnet and armature with each other, okay? So everybody is clear with the report format that we have to write, okay? So I'll just sign them. And what's this?
Yeah,
okay, so the thing is, without worrying about the use, what is this?
Bevel gear.
This is a bevel gear, right? So bevel gear is used for transmitting motion. In this case, what is it transmitting?
It is
this is a gripper, right? Essentially, it is a gripper. So when I move one of the gears, there will be some sort of a linear component which is coming inside and it is pulling it outside or pushing it inside. So essentially here you have noticed that initially 8 mm drill bit was used. So 8 mm is the standard size that is provided with this, but again use 8 to 18 mm in this kind of drill bit. So this is essentially used to hold that. Okay, and one of the things that I want to mention is, okay, what are the modifications that you want to tell? One person will tell one modification, however stupid it might be, it's fine.
Reverse the direction.
Okay, one. So I need 6 of them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Reverse the direction is first. Second is, yeah. So making it wireless, we can use lithium ion battery. We can use rechargeable battery and make it wireless. That's a good recommendation. Second, third one. Extra cooling fan. Okay, the extra cooling fan, it will just increase the size, but okay, it will be cool and the amount of RPM that we can get will be much more. Okay, the extra fan, this is the third one. Yeah, so I'll increase the number of modes, that's what you're saying. So for different material I'll have different RPM. So that's the fourth one. The thing is, what I want you to understand is, all the people that they use this, right, you are engineers, so anyway you can understand the RPM, the drill size and all. So all the people that they are using is, they are carpenters and all. So the thing is, if I have some sort of a slider for the material, if I have some sort of, see, steel, so I'll directly put it at steel, there will be some limit of RPM, there will be some limit of the drill bit size, so it will not allow larger drill bit size in order to go, first thing. So that is what, when you think from the customer perspective, yeah, essentially user friendly, right? And the second thing is, when a carpenter is holding this machine, he doesn't know whether this has to be efficient perpendicular or not. So the easiest modification that you can make here is, just have a laser pointer. So in case you are holding it a little bit tilted, he'll be able to see the tilt with the laser and he'll be able to correct this. Okay, so 6 modifications are done, I guess. 3 I only told, so you need to come up with 3 of your own. Okay, so I'll have them signed.